In this video, I would like to do an example of an arc length computation for a parametric curve, where here our x coordinate over time, so x written with respect to the parameter t, is t to the fourth over 16 plus 1 over 2t squared. And then y as a function of t is just y of t equals t. We will be computing the length of this curve as it travels from this point to this one. That's going to give us the domain for our parameter t. And if you compare the y-coordinates of these points to our description for y as a function of time, you'll recognize that since y is t, when y is 1, t is 1. So we can think of this as the point r of 1 on our curve. And this one is r of 3. Okay, so when we integrate, the lower bound of our integral will be 1 and the upper bound will be 3. We need to set up the integrand here. So the thing we have to do is differentiate the x coordinate with respect to t, square that, and add to that the square of the derivative of the y coordinate with respect to t. The computation here can be a little bit tricky. So what I would like for you to do is go ahead and try that. So differentiate each of these coordinates with respect to t, square their derivatives, add them together. We will need to take the square root of that sum. I claim it can be done by hand. So sometimes with arc length computations, you end up with an integrand that you can't actually typically integrate by hand, but in this case, we really can. So go ahead and try it. See if you can take it as far as you can. If you get stuck, then that's why I chose this problem as an example. So I will come back and work through this entire computation. If you were able to get all the way to the length of this curve as we travel from t equals 1 to t equals 3, great job. However, I still think it's worth watching me move through this computation because it's possible that I will simplify it in a way which is more efficient than what you did. That happens sometimes. So I've seen people do this kind of computation where they end up with more expressions than they need along the way. So I'll just say it that way. So what would I do? I'm going to take each of these coordinates and differentiate them with respect to t. As I do so, I will square them and add their results. Okay, so we'll have dx dt, square that, and add to that dy dt squared. Then we'll end up taking a square root and computing an integral, but let's set those aside for now. Okay, so dx dt is going to be 4t cubed over 16, which reduces to t cubed over 4. And then let me think of this as 1/2 times t to the negative 2. So that's negative 2t to the negative 3. Square that. And then dy dt is just 1. So we will add to this 1 squared. Okay. Let me just go ahead, make a little annotation here. 1/2 times negative 2 is negative 1. So I could think of this as minus 1 over t cubed. Let's expand this. So t cubed over 4 squared is t to the 6th over 16. And then I need to do this times this plus this times this. So the outer and inner terms, if you're FOILing, the t cubes cancel. And we end up with minus a 4th minus a 4th. So if you were expanding like this, you should have seen that happen. And overall, that's minus 1/2. So that's the product of the mixed terms added together. And then we square this term. And we get 1 over t to the 6th. And then here, plus 1. Okay. The thing is, notice what will happen when I take negative 1/2 and add to it 1. It's going to take this 1/2 expression and just flip its sign. So I can go ahead and do that. So now this sum has turned into t to the 6th over 16 plus 1/2 plus 1 over t to the 6th. What I've seen some people do at this point is try to find a common denominator and simplify that way. You will get to the correct answer as long as you're doing everything correctly, but it's more work than you need to do. Notice how similar this expression is to what we got when we just squared this term. So there's just one tiny little difference, and that is the sign here. So adding this 1 just flipped the sign of this middle term. Take a moment to relate that back to the expressions we were squaring. So can you see a way to modify this so that its square would be our new expression here? Because when you see that connection, anytime you have this kind of operation, when you're doing these kinds of computations, you'll recognize it from now on. So recognize what flipping the sign does to this term here. So it's related. Okay, let me step aside for a moment while you think that through. What I was trying to lead you to with my description there was that the only reason this expression was negative was because of the negative sign here. If this had been a sum of terms being squared rather than a difference of terms, we would have gotten exactly this. So all the same products give us these same expressions, and then the sign here was being determined just by that subtraction in the expression we had here, which means I immediately know how to factor this because we have the factorization up here. So it's going to be t to the third power over 4, and then instead of minus 1 over t cubed, it's plus 1 over t cubed. I've seen this kind of computation so many times in calculus problems of this nature, where you're adding squares together, you end up just flipping the sign of the middle term. And all you have to recognize is that that means this expression is just going to have a sign change. So I don't need to start trying to figure out some clever way to factor this. It's given to me by the line above. Oh, sorry, I forgot the square. There we go. Okay, and now we're really good to go, because we need to take the square root of everything. So let me just add that into this computation. We want the square root of this. So we'll take the square root of that, square root of that, square root of this, so that we now have an integrand that's going to look like just t cubed over 4 plus 1 over t cubed. All right, I think I'm going to find a different marker. So as I do so, take a moment to think over this if you didn't see the connection between this line and that line, like I was trying to get you to. If you need, you can expand this and verify that we do, in fact, get back this middle expression. Otherwise, if you're feeling solid with the computation so far, go ahead and anti-differentiate this, integrate it rather from t equals 1 to t equals 3. Now it's pretty routine from here on out. So the heart of this problem is really right here. All right, let's go ahead and finish this problem. So we want to integrate the expression that we just arrived at from 1 to 3. The integrand is very similar to dy dt, if you see that connection, which means that the antiderivative is going to be very similar to the original expression for y, except for the sign change. So we'll have the antiderivative of t cubed over 4 is t to the fourth over 16. And then we will have minus 1 over 2 t squared. Like that. Okay, so let's plug in top and bottom bounds. 3 to the fourth is like 3 squared squared, so 9 squared is 81, 81 over 16. And then minus 1 over 2 times 9, which is 18. Then minus, plug in 1, and we get 1 16th. And then minus 1 half. 81 minus 1 over 16 is 80 over 16. Divide top and bottom by 8, and that's 10 over 2. Oh, it's 5. Okay, so these two together give us 5. And then we have minus 1 over 18 plus 1 half. Let me write that as plus 9 over 18. So that we get 5 plus 8 over 18. Which is 4 over 9. And that's looks totally fine to me, but 5 times 9 is 45. So if you'd like, you could write this as 49 over 9. Okay, so that wraps up this example. I hope you enjoyed seeing my approach to setting up the integrand in particular, given this form of our parametric curve. And hopefully some of the simplification I did along the way kind of illuminated something that you may be looking at in your own work. Thank you for your attention.